few miles from the border where white Rhodesia meets black Africa, farmers' wives prepare to defend themselves from attack by black nationalist guerrillas who are trying to bring down the regime of Prime Minister Ian Smith.
FN, which most of us know how to use, and we would only use it if something happened to our husbands, if they were injured or killed or something.
Since Rhodesia declared its independence from Britain 10 years ago, the illegal Smith government has consistently maintained that there would be no black rule this century in Rhodesia, a country in which blacks outnumber whites by 20 to 1.
Cocking handle here.
Now, yet again, there's talk of a constitutional settlement. If that settlement fails, the guerrillas are preparing to seize what the white settlers are determined to defend.
People have been ambushed in cars, and if you've got a gun and a terrorist is firing at you, you've got at least some chance of hitting one back. Well, if you haven't got a gun, well, you're just a sitting duck, aren't you? And the same thing applies if your house is attacked, that if you fire back at them, they're quite liable to run away. We hope so, anyway.
If it is dangerous out here, why haven't you considered leaving?
Where do you go to? I mean, this is our way of life, and we're prepared to stay, so here we are to stay. There's no point in leaving. What you're running from? I mean, there's trouble all over the world if you go and look at it. So we might as well stick around.
We were sitting having dinner and watching TV, and they hit us with a rocket and automatic machine gun fire. But it happened so quickly, these things happen so quickly that one doesn't quite appreciate for a few seconds just exactly what is happening.
Bob Horsler left Britain and settled in Rhodesia just after the war. For 20 years, he's been running an African store a few miles from the border. The attack came a month ago.
Were you surprised at the attack?
Oh, yes, one didn't expect it. I didn't expect it for the main reason that I do such an awful lot for these people. If they're in trouble, they want to telephone, they want mail, they want various things that I do for them, and I do so much for them, that I thought I would be the last person who would be hit.
Have you thought of leaving this area?
No, I haven't given a thought. Well, I've been in Rhodesia now for 30 years, and I've spent 19 years building up this business, and one doesn't just walk out on a lifetime's work.
Rhodesia's sporadic but bloody war has been fought in the northeast corner, in the Centenary district, 100 miles from Salisbury. The guerrillas attack Rhodesia from their training camps in Mozambique. There have been 900 casualties in 2 years' fighting. St. Albert's is a favourite target, a quarter of a mile from Ian Stacey's farm.
What's the fence for, Ian?
Well, when this thing first started back in 72, a few of the first attacks, you know, the terrorists came up, you know, and were throwing grenades through the window and shooting through the window. So it's just put up really as a protection. Not that it really protects you, but it gives you a state of security, you know. You've got to be able to sleep at night.
You are very exposed out here, aren't you?
We are very exposed,
there's nothing for miles
very around. Exposed, yeah. And we're very near the escarpment, you know, which is where they come from, over the Zambezi there. Very near the edge. The very first attack in the area was, it was a farm about 12 miles to the west of us here, and the terrorists tossed a hand grenade through into the bedroom where there were two children asleep. So the first thing we all did was quickly rush and put these things up to stop that.
Do you have a gun in the bedroom at night?
Yes, yeah, I keep a gun in the bedroom next to my bed, yes. Oh, yes. And load it with a safety catch on, ready in case. And that's something, it just comes natural now, you know, like when you pick your book up to read. I mean, as soon as you get in bed, you get the gun out the gun cabinet, put next to your bed.
Ian Stacey is a tobacco farmer. Sanctions have left his business virtually unscathed. His crop is bought by foreign buyers, often illegally, and exported, probably, via South Africa. He employs 50 Africans, whom he pays an average wage of £2 a week. Some of their children work for him too, even at 10 and 12. Only a few of them go to school. Ian Stacey also feeds and clothes his workers, and is currently putting up a fence for them too. He claims the Africans welcome it because it keeps the guerrillas out. It also cuts the guerrillas off from the food and supplies they need.
Is there a danger that perhaps some of your African workers may think that you are fencing them in rather than keeping others out?
I don't think so, because They've found farms and also areas which have had bad terrorist infiltration. These chaps, you know, have sort of asked for fencing. They started asking for it soon after the European homesteads were fenced.
Can you ask your men here what they think the fence is for?
Twabi? Any law in Chitigalo, my fence, when is? Any lot in a fagalo? Yeah.
Yeah, when is it?
Eh? When a funnel offence? I got a mush offence.
Mush is munch.
I got a mush got a gandang and a weird doozy when I was key gate and I got a skinner.
Yeah.
I got a shupa, fuzz, and picnic.
Yeah.
What did he say?
Yeah, he says, yeah, you know, geese, so just keep the terrorists away from his family. And then, because this is a basic problem. I think most of these Africans are not the slightest interest in terrorists, you know, but unless you can guarantee them some sort of protection, I mean, then naturally they're going to sort of help out the terrorists.
Every farmer is a member of the police reserve and goes out on patrol once a week. They know their ground and they know their Africans in a way that regular soldiers seldom do. Since the war began, security forces have killed nearly 600 guerrillas and have lost 75 soldiers and police.
Do you accept the principle of black majority rule?
I'm not against black rule or yellow rule. I don't care a damn what colour the government is, long as it's a responsible government. I don't mind whether it's black, whether it's all white, long as it is responsible. And I think this is the crux of the whole matter at the moment.
How soon would you be prepared to accept black majority rule?
Well, here again, it depends how efficient the black majority rule is going to be. At the moment, I can't see it under 5 years, because I can't see that how anybody is going to come up and be qualified enough to take it over under 5 years.
And the alternative to a settlement is what?
I feel actually quite confident there will be a settlement. The alternative to a settlement, I suppose we'll just go on. And as you say, I expect the terrorist activity will increase. Which is not a nice thought, but I feel I'm quite sure we can contend with it.
Do you ever think about the future? Do you ever think about the possibility of the war being intensified, of you living out here being in the firing line?
Yes, I do. But this is where we live and this is where we're going to stay. And I think that, you know, we've got as much right here as anyone else. We've helped to make this country what it is.
A school in the African township of Highfield, a few miles outside Salisbury.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Rhodesia's next generation of Africans are being taught English, the language of their European masters. The teacher is Mary Gabella.
Stand up. Jump. Jump again. Turn round. Turn round again. Now sit down.
Their parents have watched the recent drama of history in Africa, the end of colonialism, the birth of black nationalism.
Hands up, please. What am I doing?
They hope that they and their children will see almost the last act in Africa, black majority rule in Rhodesia, and most hope, peacefully.
Miss, what am I doing?
The teacher, Mary Gabella, lives in Highfield with her husband and three children. Her 18-year-old nephew, Josiah, is part of the family. Highfield is one of the African townships that straggle out of Salisbury. In Rhodesia, public education and housing are segregated. There's no apartheid, but there are nagging restrictions on the African social and political freedom. By African standards, the Gabellas are comfortably off. They're buying their own house. But their nephew Josiah is not as fortunate. Despite the fact he's got 5 O-levels, he can't find a job.
Do you do this every day, read the paper, look for a job?
Yes, every day. And nearly every day I write an application letter.
And what happens every day?
Every day I receive a series of regrets.
What about your friends that you were at school with? Are they in the same position as you?
Yes, nobody is employed. I met them, about 70% of them, they are not employed.
70% of the
people you're at school with have no jobs either?
Yes.
Mary's husband George has a university degree and he works as a personnel officer.
What's it like generally being an African living in Rhodesia, which is run by a white government?
Frustrating. I cannot attend a meeting.
A political meeting?
Yep, which is really illegal. If I did attend then, yeah, I knew it was illegal, you know. And such laws like I cannot drink in town after 7 o'clock. So I say, you know, there isn't that social freedom where you can do what you want, when you want it, and at whatever place you want it.
What's the maximum period of time that you will be prepared to wait before majority rule?
Well, I would love that it'd be 1 year, but I would say programmed between 2 and 5 years. But I wouldn't go beyond 5 years at all. Well, in this, I'm thinking more of my kids, you know. I believe they will have a future, a sort of free future where they can decide their own destiny, you know, where they can go to any place, the restrictions of either being black or white, like any other children of various countries where they can decide their own destiny and go where they want at the time they want. This is the sort of future I expect.
Do you think the majority of Africans here do support the people who are fighting?
I think they've got sympathies. I wouldn't say they quite support overtly like that, but they've got sympathies with people who are fighting.
Why do you say that?
Mainly because these people are coming into their own country and they are not usurpers from outside, you know. These are kids who have born here and who are coming back home trying to fight for their own rights, and therefore naturally would have sympathies with them, that if they won, then they will have won freedom for everyone.
How do you see the future now?
There are two ways I see the future. The future could be a prosperous future if there was a negotiated settlement. The future could be disastrous if the guerrillas were forced to escalate and the power was wrested from the rulers now.
You want a negotiated settlement?
I want, very, very strongly, I would like a negotiated settlement where there would be little disruption and more development.
If we are to have a lasting solution in this country, a settlement that will not, that will stop any other forces against this country, it must be inclusive. It must not be seen to leave other people out. And this is a very strong feeling I have. And that means, and this is why we must have some of our people who are outside, and therefore we must have it outside.
But Mr. Smith won't leave Rhodesia for negotiations. A possible way of breaking the deadlock is to hold a conference at Victoria Falls, the border between White Rhodesia and Black Zambia. That way, both sides could attend.
Is that the kind of compromise that could possibly be worked out?
Well, the idea at a glance seems silly, but if that becomes a serious idea, and we all felt that we had to do that, I don't see why not.
You would be prepared to go, to Victoria Falls?
I'll be prepared to go to that.
What does Mr. Smith have to concede to you to make a settlement possible from your point of view?
Well, Mr. Smith has been heard all over the world to say that he did not want to see majority rule in his lifetime. And if we are going to go to talk business, Mr. Smith should concede to the principle and of majority rule as a basis of discussion.
So Mr. Smith has to accept the principle of majority rule?
That is correct. And he has to accept majority rule in his lifetime.
What happens if there is no settlement? What's the future then?
What it means is that we'll have a long drawn fighting by the freedom fighters from outside and the people here. They do tell us, and we think they've got a strong army, but so that would mean a longer time, many people losing their lives, and of course at the end they will come and talk like we should be talking now.
Would you give your blessing to that war, to the guerrillas?
I would be very sorry that we did not have enough statesmanlike people to avoid that. But I would believe that I would lose my, my self-respect and that of my people if we did not defend ourselves. And on the basis of self-defense, I would support it.
Are you optimistic about the future?
I certainly am. Because there is nothing that is going to stop the establishment of majority rule in this country. It doesn't matter how many people will die, how many people will be assassinated, but the truth is majority rule is inevitable.
Sanctions have not stopped Ian Stacey from selling his tobacco or from getting spare parts for his farm machinery, most of it illegally imported from Britain.
Oh, morning. Yeah, let's find the book of words.
The world has turned a blind eye on sanctions.
Fan belts. Yep. Four fan belts. 135.
Rhodesia had what the world needed, tobacco, chrome and minerals. And in return, the world sold Rhodesia what she wanted.
I wonder if you can get me the number of that. Can you look it up in your book for me?
If the United Nations sanctions had been ruthlessly applied, Rhodesia might have choked and not simply caught her breath. But now the situation may be changing. Rhodesia's lifelines are her railways, the arteries that keep her economy going. Rhodesia is landlocked. She depends heavily on her rail links with Mozambique, to the port of Beira in the north and Lourenço Marques in the south. Yesterday, Mozambique became a black independent state. If she closes her border, Rhodesia will have to rely on the already overloaded links through Botswana and Beitbridge to South Africa. The strains will be enormous.
Prime Minister, what will happen if Mozambique does close her border?
If the Mozambique border is closed, there will be adverse effects, but I want to assure you that we have done a tremendous amount of contingency planning in order to cope with this, and I'm happy to tell you that the reports which I have had indicate to me that the position will not be as bad as we had originally anticipated.
I assume that those contingency plans rely heavily on South African support and cooperation, do they?
It's a fair assumption to make that, yes.
Do you think that the prospects for a constitutional conference are now getting better or worse?
Well, it's very difficult to answer that. Some days they seem to be better and some days they seem to be worse. I regret to have to tell you that there doesn't really seem to be any consistency in the thinking of the ANC. Their minds seem to change from day to day almost with the wind. And I'm not being provocative. This is a true statement of the situation.
Which of the ANC leaders would you prefer to do business with?
At the moment, there are about a half a dozen potential leaders, all claiming to lead the ANC. And this does put us in a position where, in many ways, the ANC is leaderless.
But, Mr. Smith, the leader of the ANC at this moment is Bishop Muzorewa. Isn't he the man that you have to do business with?
Well, it is a fact that the ANC has not had a Congress and elected their leader. I believe I'm correct when I say that it was always regarded that Bishop Muzorewa would act as a stopgap.
The one concession that Bishop Muzorewa told me that you had to be prepared to make a settlement possible, was that you had to accept black majority rule in your lifetime. Is that a concession that you would be prepared to make?
You're asking me to disclose some of my cards beforehand and without my opponents doing the same. And I know from experience that this is not advantageous as far as I am concerned.
But your lifetime may be one of your cards.
Well, it may be, but this will be something for the conference table.
If there is no settlement, do you accept that you will probably have to fight?
Yes. Yes, I think that it is fair speculation to believe that.
you accept that if there is no settlement, then the war that you're fighting at the moment will probably be intensified?
Yes, I think that is a fair assumption.
One idea which has been floated as a way to end the deadlock is that the conference should be held at Victoria Falls. Your delegation would therefore stay in Rhodesia, and the ANC delegation would stay in Zambia. Would that be a possibility?
I should imagine that's a possibility. But I must tell you that I have had no such suggestion put to me, so I don't believe that this is the sort of problem that is worrying the ANC.
When I interviewed Bishop Mazarewa and I put that suggestion to him, he said that he would be prepared to consider Victoria Falls as a location for the conference, as a way out of the impasse. Would you?
Well, I hope he will pass the message on to me. As yet, I have had no such message, no such communication.
If the bishop does pass his message to you, suggesting Victoria Falls as a location for the conference, would you view that favorably?
Well, I will give it consideration, sure. I think it is undesirable for me to put myself in a position where I'm negotiating this sort of thing in public. Quite frankly, I don't believe that this helps.
But you would be prepared to consider Victoria
Certainly.
Falls?
Certainly. I must keep an open mind and consider any reasonable proposition that is put before me.
Victoria Falls is on the Zambezi River, which marks the political border between black governments to the north and white governments to the south. The dramatic changes of the past few months in Angola and Mozambique have now exposed and isolated the two remaining white regimes in Africa, Rhodesia and South Africa. These changes have raised the hopes of black Rhodesians, who are now in no mood to see them dashed. They may even have persuaded white Rhodesians to settle.
And so Bishop Mazarewa and Mr. Smith have both said that they are prepared to consider coming here for a conference at Victoria Falls. If both sides have a genuine desire for a settlement, then that settlement could be reached here, the point at which black Africa meets white. If there is a settlement, and a settlement to which all sections of the ANC are party, then there's a fair chance of peaceful progress towards majority rule. But if there is no settlement, or if that settlement is only recognised by a part of the ANC, then the guerrillas will fight on, and they'll do so with more support and more sympathy than they have at the moment. That is the choice facing Rhodesia today.